Thankfully, I am not the only guy here who grew up in this church. We have youth here. Some of them have become young adults. Scary, amen. Some of them have had children of their own. But it's beautiful to see God's church grow in that manner as well, that we can raise up a generation. If you would, go ahead and take your Bibles, turn to Psalm 138. Psalm 138. And we're going to look at this psalm in its entirety. Psalm 138. Psalm 138. When you get there, just give me a smile or a nod. Most of y'all are there. That's a pretty smile, man. That's very good. I think most of you are there. Psalm 138, a psalm of David. I will praise you with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing praises to you. I will worship towards your holy temple and praise your name for your loving kindness and your truth. For you have magnified your word above all your name. In the day when I cried out, you answered me, and made me bold with strength in my soul. All the kings of the earth shall praise you, O Lord. When they hear the words of your mouth, yes, they shall sing the ways of the Lord. For great is the glory of the Lord. Though the Lord is on high, yet he regards the lowly, but the proud he knows from afar. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you revive me. You will stretch out your hand against the wrath of my enemies, and your right hand will save me. The Lord will perfect that which concerns me. Your mercy, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the works of your hands. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you for this word. We thank you for this beautiful psalm. God, that you would just move me aside right now. Let the very Spirit of Jesus minister to every heart, mind, and soul here, Lord, that we may be one in the Spirit. And God, if there's anyone here who is hurting, Lord, may you heal their hurt. God, if there's anybody who is healing here, may they rejoice at the work of the Lord. And God, I pray that we would all be found before you as your children today. And I pray this in the name of Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. So, during the days of the early church, when things were just getting moving, when the Holy Spirit had came upon the apostles and they were going out and preaching the word of God, and one of the first times 3,000 came to the Lord. What an amazing number of people that would receive the Lord Jesus. And as the gospel began to spread and continue to pour out on the masses, the Jewish church at the time saw this as a bad thing, and they brought in the apostles a few times, and they reprimanded them. But early on, before any of the heavy persecution began, the apostles had so many people to take care of, it wasn't enough for just these 12 guys to take care of now. They needed help. And so they enlisted the congregation to pick out 7 among them, men full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom. And they set these men aside, and they called them, how many of y'all know what they called them? Deacons. Amen? They called them deacons. And the word deacon simply means say a servant. And so they set these men aside to take care of the people, because as the apostle said, we cannot neglect our prayers and the word of God. We need help. But one of these guys, his name was Stephen, and it says that he was full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, and he would confound those who would say that Christ and the way of Christ was wrong. And he would confound the Jews, so much so that they built up false charges against him with the Sanhedrin, which is the ruling body of the religious Jews. And so they brought him before the Sanhedrin and made these accusations to this man. And Stephen, he's innocent. It says that he had like the face of an angel. He hadn't did anything wrong to anybody. And so as he stood before all these Jewish elders, he begins to tell them the story of Abraham. And then he begins to tell them the story of Joseph and then Jacob. And then he touched on Moses and how Moses received the law. And eventually he began to talk about Solomon when he built the beautiful temple that they could see before them to worship God in. But then he says this, Listen to this. In Acts chapter 7, yet the Most High does not dwell in houses made with human hands. But as the prophet says, heaven is my throne, the earth is my footstool. What kind of house will you build for me, says the Lord? Or what is a place where I will find my rest? Did not my hands make all these things? And then Stephen said this to them, you stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in heart and ears, you are forever opposing the Holy Spirit, just as you and your ancestors did. Which of the prophets did your ancestors not persecute? They killed those who foretold the coming of the righteous one, and now you have become his betrayers and murderers. You are the ones that received the law as ordained by angels, and yet you have not kept it. Do you think that went over well? No, it did not. When he said these words, the whole body of the Jewish elders began to be angry and upset. And then it says Stephen had a vision of Jesus in the heaven beside the right hand of the Father. And he tells them this. And so then the Jewish elders begin to rend their clothes and gnash their teeth. And they drag Stephen out of the city and stoned him. And there was a young man who was a Pharisee by the name of Saul, who later we know as the Apostle Paul. But he stood by consenting to the death of this man who was endangering the very temple and the religion of the Jews. Stephen is what we call the first Christian what? Martyr. You know, the word witness in the Greek is martyros. This is where we actually get the word martyr. It means witness. Now, witness, what we call, is like a living testament or someone who gives a living testimony of what has taken place. And so Christians, Stephen was a living witness to the Jews that rejected Jesus. And let me tell you this, Stephen is still today a living witness. Do you know why? Because Christ lives. You and I can be living witnesses of what Jesus has done in our own lives. We are witnesses. I want to be a witness right now of Jesus. Without Jesus, I would not be here. Without Jesus, I would not have the wife I have. Without Jesus, I would not have these awesome, amazing kids that I have. Without Jesus, I would have nothing. Without Jesus, I would not have eternal life in him. Without Jesus, I would not be able to stand before you. Without Jesus, I am nothing, and I will go back to nothing without Jesus. I'm here because of God's word, God's spirit, and God's people. And all these three are held together by Jesus. So this morning, we actually have with us today God's word, God's Holy Spirit, and who? God's people. We got some God's people up in here. Amen. You can be loud. This is church. It's okay to tell others you love Jesus. Amen. And so, listen, we have these three, and I'm a testimony of that. Like I said earlier to the kids, very genuinely, I grew up in this church. It's truly amazing. It's wonderful that I got to grow up in a church. And listen, if my parents were a godly parents, I wouldn't be where I am. There's no way. There's no way I'd be here. My dad gave me some of the best advice ever, because as I was growing and shaping my relationship with Jesus here, and some of you got to grow up in this church well, which is awesome. All of us should be sharpening and becoming the men and women of God that God truly wants us to be. And so when I was growing and developing, I knew I felt called in the ministry, but I just was not sure until I really had to take that step of faith and say, okay, I'm going to do this. And I told my dad, because, you know, I wanted him to pay for college, right? And I remember, like, the serious conversation, because my dad, if you know my dad, he doesn't say a lot, all right? But when he does speak, you listen, because what he has to say is very important. And so he said, son, I have three things to tell you. If you really want to do this, if you really want to go in the ministry, because listen, my dad was a deacon here, and he still is a deacon. He can't be on the active board, though. Amen? He might be too lenient on me, or he might be too hard. But during the years of 1980 and about 1991, this church went through 10 pastors. 10 pastors. And you know, the culture of South Carolina, do you know how long a minister stays in ministry at a church? about 18 months, a year and a half. South Carolina terminates more ministers than most states. I don't know what it is. It might be the humidity. I don't know. But we see this culture of me, this culture of me that's always been with society, that's always been with humanity, this culture of me. In church, the only thing that'll break a culture of me is Jesus. The only thing that'll break a culture of me is Holy Spirit. Now, these are the three things my father told me. They're very important. He said, number one, Chris, you cannot halfway do ministry. It's either all the way or none at all. Do you know that's your walk with Jesus? You can't halfway your walk with Jesus. Let me tell you, we are all called into ministry here. If you've been bought by the blood of Jesus, then you've been called into his ministry. You know what that ministry is? To be a living testimony and witness of his love. We all can't halfway our walk with Jesus. And then he told me this. He said, church always changes. And it does. Everything around us is always in constant change. People will come and go. The seasons will change. But listen, he said, God remains and is always constant forever. Do not put your faith in mortal man who will die, but in the everlasting God who is forever. Amen? And this is the final one. This is very important. He said, don't let the people take your heart. Because that belongs to Jesus. Amen. Really, these three things he told me before I even stepped into the realm of ministry, every Christian needs to apply this same wisdom to their hearts. So that you can be a testimony and a witness. So that you, as David proclaims in this psalm, I will praise you with what? What does he say in this psalm? I will praise you with what? My whole heart. Amen. Go ahead and say it with me. My whole heart. Do it again. My whole heart. Amen. I will praise you with my whole heart. Amen. And so when we look at this in the Hebrew, my whole heart means everything inside of me. My entire inner being, I will praise you with my whole heart. Now this word praise cannot be taken away from this other word called thanks. If you know your God, then God will reveal to you what he's done for you in your life. And you will be thankful. You will be thankful. It says all the wonderful gifts from heaven come from the Father, who there is no variation or shape to change. It is God who loves you. He is constant in your life. And so Christians, we have today the same verse 1. I will praise you with what? My whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing to you praises. David lived in a time when people worshiped false idols and false gods. Matter of fact, he would wage war on those who did. But in today's time, we still have false gods and we still have idols that people worship. And so today we are called to be living witnesses that we will praise him with our whole being before all the gods around us, that we may show everyone the true and living God. This is our testimony. This is what we are called to do. Without the Spirit of God, we would not be able to praise appropriately. And you really can look at the spread of all the world religions and all of the cults out there, and not one in Christianity where you find these kind of psalms. How many of you have ever seen people worship the Lord? Some people worship quietly. They'll put their hands here and they'll sing, and they'll just kind of sway a little bit. Have you ever seen do that? And there's some Christians, when they worship the Lord and they sing and praise him, they'll put their arms up, and they'll get loud and like, Lord, I love you. Thank you so much. Amen. You know, we just have all forms of types of worship. And listen, all of that is acceptable praise to Jesus. Because you know what? He sees here. He sees right through the skin and to the intent and the desire of the heart. God sees us. This psalm right here is very beautiful. It kind of plays out in a few stories in the Bible. One, we know this story out of the book of Daniel. This is a very interesting story. We know that the Jews were taken into captivity by the Babylonians. And it was Daniel and three of his friends. What was his friend's name? Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. Amen. We know the story. That was not their Hebrew given names. They were all renamed after false gods. But while they were there, the king Nebuchadnezzar saw the wisdom and spirit, unlike any other, gave them high position. And for some reason, this Nebuchadnezzar makes this 90-foot tall golden statue of himself. He must have really liked himself. How many of you would actually appreciate that if someone made a golden statue of you that big? You know, I don't even like it when people take pictures too close to me. Amen? It's too close, right? They made this humongous 90-foot statue made of pure gold and jewels. And whenever his little band played music, everyone in the city had to stop exactly what they were doing and bow down and worship this golden idol. Isn't this insane? And so these three men would not do that. Whenever the music would play, they would not worship. And so, listen, the Chaldeans, which were the other sages or wise men, they noticed this, they didn't like him, and so they told the king, "Hey, king, oh, great Nebuchadnezzar, they're not worshiping like you asked them to, and you did make a decree, anyone who doesn't will be cast in a blazing furnace." And so, it infuriated the king. Matter of fact, it says in Daniel 3:16, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered the king. He was furious, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not intend to present ourselves a defense. If our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the furnace of blazing fire and out of your hand, O king, let him deliver us. But if not, be it known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods. We will not worship the golden statue that you have set up." They said, if God saves us, he saves us. If he doesn't, he doesn't. But at the end, we're not going to worship your false idol. Nebuchadnezzar was filled with rage against them. His face was distorted. He ordered that the furnace be heated 7 times its normal heat. He ordered that the strongest guards in the army bind them. And then he ordered his strongest men to throw them in the blazing furnace. And the furnace was so hot that it killed the men who actually threw them in the furnace. So if you get this idea, he did the worst he possibly could do to make sure that they understood the weight of their crime. "I'm going to get this so hot, when you go in there, you're not even going to exist anymore." And the king, off in a distance, sees, it says, 4 men inside, unbound. And the fourth looked like the Son of God. So interesting, right? And these men, when they came out of the furnace, they were unsinged. Their hair, they didn't even smell like they had been in a furnace. But the one thing that was burned away was what? Their bindings. Amen? Their bindings was burned away. And this is the decree that King Nebuchadnezzar made after this amazing event. He said this, "Therefore, I make a decree, any people, nation, or language that utters blasphemy against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego will be torn from limb and his house laid to ruins, for there is no other God who is able to deliver this way." Their testimony led to this pagan king glorifying who? God. Isn't this interesting? Many years later, after another king started to reign, his name was Darius, the wise men tricked him into making another, a different edict by saying, every day you are to pray to no other name than King Darius. And so they knew that Daniel would not do this. And so they ratted Daniel out. They said, Daniel, he goes to this place and he continues to pray. And listen, Darius, he kind of liked Daniel. But his word was law. And so they were going to put him in a pit full of what? Lions. Amen. And he said, Daniel, I pray your God is able to save you. And they sealed it up. And it said that night, King Darius prayed and fasted all night for Daniel. Who was he praying and fasting to? I believe he was praying and fasting to Daniel's God. And here's Daniel. He probably slept pretty good. Right? They opened that lid up, and there is Daniel and the lion. And King Darius said, was your God able to deliver you, Daniel? And Daniel said, yes, he sent his angel to shut their mouths. And King Darius had everybody who accused Daniel. Listen, they didn't teach me this in Sunday school. I just want to let y'all know this, all right? They didn't teach this in Sunday school for a good reason. But the king threw everyone who condemned Daniel into the lion's pit. The same lions that Daniel was in the pit with, it says before they even hit the ground, the lions had already broken all their bones. And then the king made this decree. I make a decree that in my royal dominion, people should tremble in fear before the God of Daniel, for he is the living God, enduring forever. His kingdom shall never be destroyed, and his dominion has no end. He delivers and rescues, his works, signs, and wonders in all the heavens and the earth. For he has saved Daniel from the power of the lions. Here is Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. Here is Daniel. And they were witnesses of who? God. Because they praised him with what? Their whole heart. With everything they had in them. They praised him. They put him first in their entire lives. And listen, because they were living witnesses, these pagan kings proclaimed his name. Look at this psalm in verse 4. All the kings of the earth shall do what? Praise you. Let me ask you a question. Is America filled with idol worship? Yes. Is it filled with false gods? Well, yes. How will those who worship these false idols and dead gods, how will they ever know to praise the true God with their whole heart if they do not see God's people today praise him with all of their hearts, with all their strength, soul, mind, if we're not praising God? Do you know when there's an inappropriate time to praise God? Never. There's never an inappropriate time to praise God. We should give thanks in all circumstances. Listen, you know how challenging that is? Very challenging. But why can we do this? Because God does not think like we do. God is God. God knows us before time began. God has always been. And God loved you before the foundations of this earth. He loved you and chose you in his love. And if you've ever talked to somebody who does not understand that kind of love, it is sad. Because everyone should experience that kind of love. The kind of love that says, I will worship toward your holy temple and praise your name for your loving kindness and your truth. For you have magnified your word above all your name. In the day I cried out, you answered me and made me both bold and strengthened in soul. God is always there ready to answer the call from you. Just at one moment. How many of you can think of times where you needed and you had to call out to Jesus? He was there. He was there. In this psalm, it says in verse 5, yes, they shall sing of the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. Though the Lord is on high, he regards the lowly, but the proud he knows from afar off. God, in his splendor and beauty, left heaven and lived in the flesh, The Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen His glory, the glory as a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. This is Jesus. He left splendor, came down, lived among us, and He was lowly, submissive, and He even washed the disciples' feet at one point. He made Himself submissive even to death and the shame of the cross. Jesus teaches us what humility is. But church, it says that God sees the lowly, but He is afar off from what? The prideful. There's nothing that can stop God working in our lives faster than this thing called pride. Pride will stop you dead in your tracks. How many of you have ever experienced this thing called pride? How many of you have ever heard anybody say, "I will not do that"? "Oh, no, I'm not." Any of y'all got teenagers? Come on. Y'all have heard these phrases. This thing called pride builds up barriers and walls. Blessed are those who are poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of what? Heaven. God wants us to be so spiritually hungry for Him that we thirst after God, that we thirst after Him because we're spiritually poor. The Pharisees were never hungry for Jesus or thirsty for Him because they were always full of their own self-righteousness. They were so prideful. If we could interview six guys from heaven and six guys from hell, and we got them in a room together, and they were just talking about the differences of heaven and hell, the six guys would be listening to the six guys from heaven. They're like, "Man, y'all are lucky." And they're talking, and then they begin to tell them about the darkness, the fire. And I believe that the worst thing about the concept of hell is the absence of God. It's the absence of God. That's worse than fire. That's worse than darkness. That's worse than torment. It's the absence of God. But then they started to talk about what every Baptist ends up talking about, and that's dinner. Amen? We'd like to talk about dinner. And they begin to tell the people from heaven, "Well, let us tell you about our dinner. There's this big, giant table that has the most beautiful food that you'd ever want to eat. Think of Christmas dinner or Thanksgiving, everything, something that your grandma made, and it was so good, the most beautiful amount of food. And we could not eat that food. We just had to sit there right in front of that food, and they would hand us silverware, and we could only use silverware, but they made the forks and the spoons so long that when we tried to feed ourselves, we couldn't. It wouldn't get in our mouths. It didn't matter what you would do, and you would never get to eat." And the angels were just scratching their chins like, "That's so weird. Man, that's awful. That's so weird." You see, we have the same dining room. We have the same table. Same food, it sounds like, same silverware, except we feed each other. The six men in hell were trying to feed who? Themselves, and they could never do it. The pride of man is great. The reason why our world is the way it is because we are so concerned with feeding ourselves, and we don't care about our brother and sister right beside us. Hunger and thirst after Jesus. Take cues from Jesus. Jesus suffered so that we could have eternal life and joy. "Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you revive me. You stretch out your hand against the wrath of my enemies, and your right hand will save me. The Lord will perfect that which concerns me. Your mercy, O Lord, endures how long? Forever. Do not forsake the works of your hands." We are the work of His hands. Amen. We have to be so careful about idolatry. I want to give you all five tips on how to stay away from idolatry. You ready? Because sometimes idols can work in the form of the things that we love, the things that we like to do, the hobbies. Check this out. This is when you know your fun, your hobby, your enjoyment might become your idol. Are you ready? Number one, when you put it above your relationship with God. If you are putting anything above your relationship to God, you are turning that thing, person, or place into an idol. Number two, when you put it above your relationship with your spouse and your children. Paul wrote that husbands, love your wives as what? Christ loved the church. And what did Christ do for the church? He died for it. Amen. How many of you have ever heard those men? And I've preached a sermon and I'm asked those men, would you die for your wives? Like, amen, I'd die for my wife. Amen, I'd die for my wife. How many of you men would just say that right now? Amen. Oh, sorry, ladies. Man, y'all had your chance to get some points and you ruined it. But most men would say, well, yeah, I'd die for my wife. But how about take out that trash? How about wash them dishes, buddy? What about all those little things? Jesus didn't come to die. Jesus came to live a sinless life. Everything can be mounted up into great big things, adding up small things. It's all the little decisions that we make. All the little decisions of our faith that God knows and He sees, and He wishes us to make all those right choices. We must put God first, our family second there. And listen to this, number three, when it draws you away from what God created you to do. God made you His beautiful work, and He wants you to work through His Spirit in your life to make this world better, to make your family better, to make this community better. Are you allowing God to use you, or is there an idol getting in the way? Number four, when it becomes a right or a demand for you. That means this, if you can't enjoy that fun hobby, that entertainment, you get mad when you can't experience it. You get angry. And sometimes when it's taken away from us, we will get angry at God. That might be an idol. Number five, this is the last one. When it takes up all your thoughts and time, it just might be an idol. I met a guy this week. Randall is a cool guy. He's what you would call a, have you ever heard this expression, a good old boy? Amen? Ever heard of a good old boys? Amen? And he would always describe himself as a good old boy. That's always been all of his life. But he was explaining to me his testimony because I asked him, do you know Jesus? And he's like, oh yeah, let me tell you my story. And so Randall begins to tell me his story. And it all begins, and most good old boys, the most beautiful thing they end up with is a godly wife. Somehow, God will bless them and give them a woman who loves Jesus. Or lead them into a family that loves Christ. And they're good old boys. When I say good old boys, he loves hunting, fishing, drinking, doing just fun stuff. He's just a good old boy. He's a good boy, but he's lost. And his wife and his mother-in-law, they used to get on him so bad when he was young. They'd pray for him, encourage him. His mother-in-law would say things like this, well, Randall, you know that's not right. I know, ma'am. Randall, well, you know you shouldn't say that. I know. That's not what Jesus would like. I know. Yes, ma'am. Have you ever had someone like that in your life? Amen? Someone who loves you? And he said that this woman, his mother-in-law, loved him to Jesus. And he gives the credit to this woman who loved him to Christ. But he said, to be honest with you, Pastor, it took me about close to 20 years to get it. It wasn't until the day when they were putting dirt on my mother-in-law's casket that every good work, every wonderful thing that she encouraged me, every time she reprimanded me, it all fell on my heart because this woman loved me with a godly love, and she's not going to get to see what God does in me now. And so about a few days after the funeral, he was laying in the bed. He wakes up that morning, and he just puts his arms up, and he begins to pray to Jesus to take all of the weight. And he said, Lord Jesus. And he said, Pastor, that was the best thing I'd ever done in my entire life. And Jesus saved me that moment. I felt the Spirit, and I'm not ever turning back again. I was redeemed and justified. But the thing that bothers him the most is that the woman who loved him there couldn't see it now. But he said, she will one day, though. She will one day. Because we are going to have a great homecoming. I carry this in most of my suits. This was one of my granddad's handkerchiefs. Now, I never wanted to be one of those sweating preachers. You know what I'm talking about. They're like gasping for air and they're just going like this. And they're like, we got to go over here and eat chicken in a second, right? I never want to be one of those. But listen, I am. I'm kind of like one of those, all right? I'm okay. I'll claim it. But my granddad was a World War II veteran. He had PTSD before they knew how to diagnose it. He's a very different man when he came back from the war. People would say that he'd walk into a room and light up the whole room. But I never got to know that man. But he would always tell people in the family that he was called into ministry, but just did not surrender to it. And I got the opportunity, before he passed away, to see that recognition on his face that his grandson was going to accept that call, which he did not accept. I got to have that peace and that closure. He got to have that closure. Listen, Christians, there's no better time to get closure in Jesus than now. Than now. To start your walk with Jesus now and not wait. And I know it's scary because most of the time when we think about walking with Christ, we automatically think about the things that we're going to have to give up. But you must understand what Jesus gave up to come here for us. We must understand what Jesus went through that we could have what we have and do what we do. We must understand of what every other Christian has done since Stephen, what they have given up so that we could be here and worship and have an actual word that we can read. We must remember the sacrifice that those who came before us laid down so that we could walk upon and that we can praise upon. There's no better time than now. If God is calling you, stop it. Stop saying no. If God is speaking to you, stop it. Stop saying no to the Holy Spirit. Listen, I know it's going to make you miserable until you say yes. I was miserable this few years before I accepted the call of ministry. I was miserable, and I was trying to fill it with every other void I can. And it was never enough, and it will never be enough. You have to give your life and heart to Jesus. You want peace? Find it in Jesus. Find it in Christ. But stop making the excuses that so many of us just make. You know why we make excuses? Because we can, and we will. But there's only needed one good reason. One good reason to say yes to Christ Jesus. And that's because He loved you before the foundation of the world. He loves you. Would you stand with me in prayer? Father in heaven, may we praise You with our whole hearts, our entire inner being at this moment. And God, I pray that if someone is struggling with making a decision to follow You, to be led by You, Lord, may they feel the weight of that conviction through the Holy Spirit as it's trying to draw them into alignment with You. And God, may You bless them and keep them. And God, I ask that You would bind the hands of the enemy right now as we go into this time of testimony and this time of invitation. Lord, if there is someone who does not know You today, may they not leave here without You. And I pray this in the name, the powerful name of Jesus, our soon coming King. Amen.